The Columbia Atrium presents Curing Global Health, the Case for Ending Neo-Dependency on Foreign Aid, hosted by Professor Alexander Preker.
On behalf of Columbia University and World Scientific Press, I'm delighted to invite you to this special broadcast on Curing Global Health, the Case for Ending Neo-Dependency. My name is Alexander Preker. I'm an adjunct professor at Columbia University and Mount Sinai. And I'm also the editor-in-chief for the Health Investment and Financing series of World Scientific Press. I was the former chief economist for health in the World Bank and head of the health investment policy branch of the IFC. In this session, I'm really delighted to introduce two very distinguished speakers. The first one is Dr. Soji Adeyi. He's the president of Resilient Health Systems, former director and sector manager of health, nutrition, and population in the World Bank. And he was the founder of the director of the Affordable Medicines Facility, which is part of the Global Fund for Fight Against HIV/AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria. We will have a respondent who's Sir George Alleyne. He's the Chancellor of the University of West Indies and the U.S. Secretary General and Special Envoy for HIV/AIDS in the Caribbean region. And he's also the former director of PAHO, the American branch of WHO. Okay, we'll start now with the session, and I'm going to hand over to you, Soji, to give the main presentation, and then George, after that, you'll be the respondent. Just to set the timing rate, you would be speaking for about 15 minutes, Soji, and after that, George will respond 5 to 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Professor Alex Preker and your team, and special thanks to Columbia University for the opportunity to have this conversation. We're calling it Curing Global Health, which is an indication that global health is sick. And I do not think that is an understatement at all. So global health is sick, and we're drawing attention to the need to end neo-dependency of the global south on the global north, building on themes in this book called Global Health in Practice. Now, since its publication just a few weeks ago, several colleagues have asked me what my favorite part of the book is. In truth, the entire book is my favorite, but my favorite by far is the last sentence of the book, which reads, "A brighter future is possible." So let's get to it. What is fundamentally required to enable that brighter future? One, it is time to end foreign aid for basic health commodities and basic health services. And that's going to include some 75%, three quarters, of recent estimates of foreign aid. Second is to drastically reform technical assistance in global health to make it more demand-led and less supply-driven. And the third pillar is to refocus foreign aid in those areas where the added value is highest. So it's a three-part agenda. Now let's unpack the rationale for this. Global health is now very topical for anybody on Earth. And there is a lot of interest on the inequities and inequalities that have been unmasked over the last couple of years by COVID-19. But while the COVID-19 pandemic is a global catastrophe in health and also for economies, it is not the fundamental problem in global health. Global health was seriously sick before COVID-19 came along. It just unmasked what was partially hidden until about 2 years ago. So what were these pre-existing flaws? There were two of them, to keep things fairly simple. One is the power imbalance and elite capture, the power imbalance between the global north and the global south. The second is the neo-dependency of the global south on the global north. Now, while we've put it in these two categories for simplicity, when we dive into it, we find that it is devilishly complex. But complexity is not an excuse for inaction. So how did we get here? How did global health get here? How come it is necessary to invent global health and to address this power imbalance? We could go back hundreds and hundreds of years, but to keep things simple, let's just go back 125 years. There was still slavery at that time in parts of the world. The transatlantic slave trade had not completely wound down. And of course, colonialism and imperialism were raging. You had all these empires. Now, wherever you had the transatlantic slave trade or elsewhere, and also as elements of imperialism, there was a lot of commerce involved. People were making a lot of money. And port cities did especially well. Some port cities did especially well. One of those cities was Liverpool in England. And as these sailors and the merchants and their workers started coming down with what the British saw as strange diseases, a man named Alfred Jones put down £350 to found the venerable Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine. And we're going to investigate, research, and treat people who had such diseases. 6 months later, the original London School of Tropical Medicine opened its doors. It was financed by the Treasury, and the money spent there was recouped from the colonies. Similar schools opened in Amsterdam, because I remember the Dutch were very active in colonization as well, opened in Brussels and later moved to Antwerp, and so on and so forth. Across the Atlantic, the United States, in the early part of the last century, the Rockefeller Foundation invested in opening a number of schools of tropical medicine, public health, across the world. And in fact, they put up money for the Johns Hopkins School of Public Health and the Harvard School of Public Health. Now, so think about this network of institutions, knowledge-based enterprise, and they've trained a lot of researchers, a lot of technical workers, a lot of professionals. They have made tremendous contributions to the health of the world. And we must recognize and appreciate that, and it's still ongoing today. So what's wrong with that? Well, the flip side of the coin was that this network constituted the health brigade of imperialism and the health brigade of colonial exploitation. How so? Because it provided the intellectual basis on which the global north dictated terms of engagement to the global south in matters of health. And when you merge that with the advent of development assistance for health after the Second World War and independence of the colonies, that power system endured. So we still have till today, the global north dictates the terms of engagement, and it tells the South what it can have, when it can have it, on whose terms, and how. And those are the things that are laid bare in the current pandemic of COVID-19, which is why I said COVID-19 was not the fundamental problem. It's just a revelation of what had been going on before. Now, there are channels through which these power imbalances are expressed. And predominantly, but not exclusively, look at the international organizations. So take the WHO, for example. Well, today, less than 20% of WHO's budget comes from the assessed contributions, about 16 to 18%, which means more than 80% of WHO is purchasable. So if you have the money, you can basically tell WHO what to do in your pet area. WHO has become a general contractor. And for good measure, let's take the case of Germany and France. So Germany and France are dominant members of the EU, which is adamantly opposed to waiving intellectual property rights on COVID technologies, okay? But at the same time, Germany spent money that made it possible for it to host the WHO Center for Pandemic and Epidemic Intelligence. And France did the same for the WHO Academy, which is in Lyon, which is why I say WHO is a purchasable general contractor. If you take the international financial institutions, let's stick to the IMF and the World Bank. They've contributed enormously through their analysis, policy engagement, and financing over the decades. Those contributions have been punctuated, sadly, by several misadventures. One, the structural adjustment programs of the 1980s and 90s. Two, the initial squeamishness or reluctance or slowness to tackle HIV/AIDS, and more recently, the debacle of the pandemic emergency facility, which proved spectacularly ineffective when the pandemic came along. Three, if you look at the multilateral grant financiers, take for example, Gavi and the Global Fund, it is very, very clear that they invest in fairly well delineated areas. And for the child who gets that vaccine or for the woman who gets the anti-malaria medicine, that's a good thing. We must recognize that. Having said that, the bigger picture, and this evening we're talking about the bigger picture, what I call the meta system. The bigger picture is that they have become crutches for low income countries and many lower income countries to abdicate responsibility to their own citizens, their responsibility for financing the basics in their own countries. And then if you go to bilateral grant financiers, the poster child for which is USAID, you'll find that in the case of USAID, the business model of that agency is very bad. Let's just call a spade a spade. USAID is basically a contractor of contractors. And so you have this army of contractors who have captured USAID, a parachute into countries to go and tell the natives what to do. And then they hire some of the natives as subcontractors for good measure. So if you wanted to have a business model that is guaranteed to not build capacity, that is guaranteed to not result in sustainable and durable development, the business model you should adopt is that of USAID and its other appendages, like the US President Malaria Initiative. And I know this from direct experience that the business model of the US President Malaria Initiative is just as bad and it needs to be overhauled. Now, if you go to the large private foundations, exemplar, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, they have funded a number of really good things. And we must recognize that. At the same time, it boggles the mind that most of their investments still go primarily to or through institutions in the global north. And it is time to change that. The poster child for that is the Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation, IHME in Seattle. It's just inexplicable why that would be in Seattle. Why not in the global south? For the money that goes in there, they probably could finance 5 or 10 such entities across the global south. And those entities will be more grounded in the realities than an entity in Seattle. Then of course, there are the Northern NGOs. Many NGOs do really good work, but at the same time, a subset of those NGOs are really not helpful because their advocacy infantilizes the government of the global south, and it gives them cover to keep avoiding their own responsibilities and their accountability to their own people. So you have a select group of Northern NGOs who have self-designated as all-knowing in matters that affect the global south, especially Africa, but not only Africa. So where does this leave us? The global south needs to face its reality. Now let's be clear, the effects of colonization are deep, they're still raw, it was a fundamentally wrong thing to do with lots of crimes against humanity committed in the process. They're enduring. Let's also be clear, the global north will not voluntarily give up its advantages in this, absent a credible threat from the global south. So we need to acknowledge that fairness is not the currency of geopolitics in global health. That might sound harsh, but it is the truth. Now, that means the Global South needs to engage in increasingly self-financed assertiveness instead of being supplicants. The day should be over when leaders and politicians of the Global South show up at these comical enterprises called replenishments. And some of those replenishments, they look like internet-enabled minstrel shows, quite frankly. Those days should be gone. So any entity that is now doing replenishment should be doing replenishment to transition out of its current business. That is what it means. More specifically, what are we talking about? We said end foreign aid for basic health commodities and services. This is by the year 2030. Why? That is the target year for UHC. So countries should be on notice that by 2030, there is no more traditional foreign aid for commodities and services. It also means reforming technical assistance. Any entity that insists on providing technical assistance can set up a drawdown fund and have the Global South countries manage it transparently and make the decisions. And then refocusing foreign aid where the added value is highest. So global and regional public goods, for example, research and development capacity in the Global South, institutions such as the Africa CDC, the Centers for Disease Control, and the like. And I know from direct experience that getting financing for such entities is like pulling teeth. Why? Because it entails a power shift. That is why there's so much resistance to it. If any donor insists on financing commodities, they actually do have an avenue. They should subsidize those commodities at the factory gate, get out of the way, and let the Global South countries do the importation by themselves or through their procurement agents. If we go down that route, those southern countries, those southern governments, governments of the Global South countries, become directly accountable to their own people. So it is no longer the case that when something goes wrong, they first blame a foreign capital instead of looking to their own Ministry of Finance or looking to their own parliament. It also means entities like USAID will stop hiring this army of contractors and acting as if they're actually doing development, okay? Now, Professor Dean Jamieson, who wrote the foreword to this book, he wrote that conservative opposition is inevitable. And he wasn't referring to political parties when he said conservative. He was referring to entrenched interest in the Global North and in the Global South, because there's a lot of rent seeking and gaming going on in development assistance for health. So why will there be objections from the Global South? Well, it is because the governments will finally have to take charge on the basis of responsibility and accountability. That is why. It is because officials who use foreign aid as a crutch and who engage in corruption will really have nowhere left to hide. That is why you will find opposition from the Global South. It is also because it will suddenly expose governments to some electoral consequences of poor performance. Let's face it, 30 years or so after structural adjustment, which I say was bad. Look, I was a physician at the Lagos University Teaching Hospital. I know we had to discharge patients prematurely because they couldn't pay their fees. So I saw it firsthand. But having said that, it is not the case that any government today should continue to blame that alone for its own poor performance. That is the point. In addition to that, the Northern NGOs will oppose this, not all of them, in all fairness. Some of them will oppose it. Why? Because they will no longer be able to collect rent as arbiters of what is good for the Global South. And then there will be objections from the Global North. Why? Many parts of the Global North will see value in it, but many parts will resist it because they will lose power. Remember, at the beginning we said, this enterprise called Global Health is fundamentally about geopolitics. It is fundamentally about power. So you're going to see a lot of resistance to this proposition, why it cannot be done, why it is not possible, why it just will fail, et cetera, et cetera. But you must ask yourself, cui bono, who is really benefiting from that status quo? So my time is about up, and we need to go into the really most exciting part of this evening, which is the discussion that I'm really looking forward to. So let me end as I started. My favorite sentence in this book is the last one that says, a brighter future is possible. Let's have a conversation. Let us reject the past. Let us not wallow in the past. Let us seize the future. Let us enable the global South to break out of its new dependency on the global North. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Soji. And I can see you haven't changed since you left the World Bank, and that you're taking up the flag and carrying it forward during the next phase of your career. So George, would you like to be the first one to respond? And then after you have responded, there's a few what I call up and coming leaders in the next generation. In fact, I would say it's skipping a generation. It's the next generation who's going to be left with what you have presented, Soji, and who will have to take this agenda forward. So we're going to have a few questions from regional perspectives, from some students that are from Columbia University, have been at Columbia University, or otherwise are moving into the policy area and will be the leaders of the future. George, would you like to make the first response?
Thank you very much, Alex. And I see that Soji has lost none of his passion. Well done, Soji. Thank you for asking me and giving me the opportunity. I'm not going to respond point by point to the point to the areas that Soji explored so well, because what he has done is encapsulate many of the important aspects of the book. I read the book, I found it very interesting, and I found it even more interesting as I read the acknowledgement and realized that Soji's muse was helped along during the evening by listening to Sunny Ade and to Dave Brubeck, two wildly different genres of music, but such is Soji. I think the book will be valuable for students, it'll be valuable for practitioners in global health, but I think the book is going to be valuable for anyone really who's interested in human welfare. Soji has outlined the problem, the problematic. He has outlined much of the diagnosis, and he has outlined some medicine which to many people will be as bad as castor oil and produce the same kind of effect. I'm not going to go over all of the points he raised, but what I would like to do is to take from the book some of the lessons that I have learned and some of the lessons I think would be useful for those people who are going to read the book and persuade the youngsters whom you mentioned, Alex, to become more interested in global health. The first thing I would like to point out, reading from the book, and which Soji emphasizes, but can't be emphasized enough, is actually global health is an inescapable reality. I would like to think that when Soji cites Jeff Copeland's definition of global health, he emphasizes the equity part of it. And I would like Soji to reflect a bit more on how these various parasites that he has mentioned, to what extent are they damaging the possibility of equity in global health. Unfortunately, there's no mechanism for ensuring global equity. We have mechanisms at the national level for ensuring some modicum of national equity, but there's no mechanism at the global level for ensuring global equity. And what Soji points out, which I agree, many of the instruments that were developed post 1945, which had as their objective to ensure equity, most of those instruments have passed their usefulness, are creaky or out of date, and he mentioned some of them, which are called euphemistically international organizations. So the first point is everyone should be interested, every one of us should be interested in global equity, everyone should be interested in equity in health, should I say, at the global level, and we should also be interested in health at the national level. And we should emphasize that many of the instruments for ensuring it at the global level no longer work, and Soji has pointed out why some of them no longer work. The second point which I took away, and this underpins many of the problems Soji outlines, health really has a low political priority. When we read what happens to ministries of health or ministers of health begging for money, so often we hear ministries of health in a mendicant position, and we wonder why that should be so. One of the things that Soji doesn't articulate as clearly in the book is the rationale for this weakness of health at a political level. And I think that one of the views I have taken up recently is one of the reasons that we tend to articulate health only as a good. It is a good thing to be healthy. And we do not articulate health as having some instrumental value. Health is one of the things that enhances the choices that human beings have, and we don't articulate that enough. We cite health in terms of mortality statistics. As all we know, the dead don't vote. So therefore, there is not the power of the voices to change things. And the third point lesson I've learned, and to some extent, this is explicated in the number of groups and the kinds of groups that feed at the trough of the organizations, is that national always trumps global. We can't forget that. It is the old dictum that all politics is local, but at the global level, local is national. And I was gripped particularly by the chapter on COVID, to which Soji referred. That for me was particularly painful and illustrative. The perfidy of the rich countries hoarding vaccines, hoarding equipment, while the other parts of the world lack them. And we ask, it has been suggested that this might be an example of Schadenfreude. I don't think it is. It is an example of the great philosophy of Don Corleone. It is business. It is nothing personal. It is just business. That is the way it is. And I think that the sooner the global health understands that the global doesn't have anything against it, but it has nothing for it. It is as simple as that. It is just the way they do business. And I would suggest it is not only, and this sounds harsh, it's not only a characteristic of the global north, but if there is this situation that affects many of the countries of the global south, you will find the richest of them behave exactly the same way as the countries of the global north behave because of the nature of the political system. The fourth lesson to which Soji referred obliquely is this, that logic and evidence are not enough in global health. Logic and evidence are not enough in global health. This appears in the title of the book. And I could sense in reading that part of the book, I could sense the passion and yes, the pain with which Soji wrote this chapter, because it is inconceivable that one set of countries or the agencies of one country should kill a program that obviously saved lives, that obviously stopped people from dying. And you wondered, how did these people go home and speak to their children, their wives at night, and said, you know, I really killed a program that would save lives. How do you actually do it? And they do it, I suppose, that because the international arrangements are not built on morality. The international, those people who feed at USAID's trough, they don't, and who contribute large sums to politicians have no sense. They may be moral in other aspects of their life, but when it comes to doing business in global health, there is no morality. It seems harsh to say this, but there's no morality involved. And the list of agencies which Soji mentioned, I would think that in general, that could be applied to them. Many of their practitioners don't have the same moral center in terms of dealing with the global South as we would like to happen. And the last point I'd like to make in this session is this. I think words matter. And Soji points out the many and egregious faults of the present development assistance for health, and I agree with him. But this is one perhaps deviation I would make, is I have wondered whether the words are a product of the ideology or the ideology is a product of the words. I think the word assistance is nefarious. I think it should be banned because the word in the very title, Development Assistance for Health, you bury a condition of charity, the rich handing out to the poor, the ones from the north handing out to the south. And if I had my druthers, I would ban the term assistance altogether in this context. And because it connotes the stronger handing out, being generous and handing out to the weak. And that is why, if I may be personal, that's why when I was director of PAHO, I banned the term technical assistance. Didn't use it. Use the term technical cooperation with the view that in health, and especially in global health, there is a cooperation to an ultimate end, and there is no assistance from one part to another. And over 8 years, you will not find the word donor appearing in any PAHO publication because we expunged the word donor from our lexicon. So I would like to see, and I'd hope, I'd like Soji to join me in this, in a campaign to remove the term development assistance. It is not assistance, it is cooperation with countries. And if we can have that concept cemented into our dealings with the global South, then perhaps you may have those persons who have more expertise cooperating with those persons who have less expertise towards a common end and not believing that they are being generous in giving to those who have less. So I feel very passionately about that aspect of development assistance, that we should rephrase it, reconceptualize it as not being assistance if we are all united in the idea of having global health. I think I'll stop there. There's some other lessons that come up, which I refer to on another occasion.
Well, George, many thanks. I mean, these are really, really perceptive comments. And Soji, I'll work with you in getting that addendum to the book added with the publisher so that we can put some of these comments in there. And certainly, George, and you know, first of all, Soji, this is a terrific, terrific overview of, 30 years of experience that you had in the World Bank and working in other agencies where we overlapped very closely. You were on the public health side, I was on the health economic side. And George, you were in one of the agencies that we collaborated with in the Latin America region. So I'm really delighted that some of this stuff is coming together and where we're able to think critically about both what were some successes and also what were some failures. I do want to now at this point, rather than have Soji, you give a response to that, I do want to move on to our leaders of the future because they have now heard the proposition and you're essentially passing the torch in some ways to them. I have organized several interventions here, which are organized by young leaders coming from low-income countries, from fragile states, from middle-income countries, and then countries that have gone through the process, have been part of the development program, and are now really considered part of the developed world. So I want to start with Ada Nanko, who is a student at Columbia, but who's worked for a number of years at CDC, and who's in the process of doing a PhD. She's from Nigeria. Ada, would you like to put on your video and your sound? I think you had a comment or a question you wanted to ask Soji, and I'm really delighted that you've joined us here today. Thank you very much for coming in on this.
Thank you, Dr. Preker, and thank you, Dr. Adeyi. This was a fascinating talk, and I really appreciate the elegance of just outlining the issues. As Dr. Preker says, I've been working in the global health space now with the CDC, one of the, I guess, donor organizations that is being discussed in this context. And I too have struggled with this tension of, you know, the utility of foreign aid, if it is a crutch, and how that reliance is stifling economic development, just general development, as well as the abdication of responsibility for, you know, with the government, where there's this sustained reliance on not necessarily looking inward, but always looking externally for that support. And, you know, the other side of the coin is, yes, aid is critical to at least sustaining the health infrastructure for the most vulnerable, those who would otherwise be disenfranchised without any sort of support. And I do understand where you're coming from, but my question is, given that a lot of this relies on the governance of the global southern countries, and given that there, in some cases, are fractured leadership, or just they're plagued by corruption, or they have competing priorities, what concrete suggestions do you have on getting a consortium together where there is broad agreement, and then there's broad a broad base to then start the discussions or start down the path of shifting the power imbalance?
Wow, thank you. Great question. I think there are at least two strands to what you said, and probably more. The first one is the matter of the most vulnerable. So if we're in a situation, or we're talking about a situation of war, displaced people, for example, active conflict or paraconflict situation, that's a different matter. That's perhaps primarily a humanitarian issue, but then of course also there's an interface between the humanitarian dimension and development dimension. And I think for those, then there is a case for direct humanitarian assistance in those contexts. I myself, I've worked in such contexts. I lived in Ethiopia during the war that ended in 91. I was part of the World Bank team that worked on health in immediate post-war Bosnia. And in my later years, I was point person within the health group for our work on what we then called fragile states, situations of fragility, conflict, and violence. So that's a special case. Having said that, I think there is a feedback loop between fragility on the one hand and lack of accountability on the other hand. Because if a government senses that at the end of the day, it is not accountable to its own population, then it can get away with not providing basic services. Or more importantly, it can get away, excuse me, with not making a serious effort to provide those basic services. And I think the not making a serious effort is really the crux of the matter. That is what underpins what I call the Neo-Dependency problem. So those two can go hand in hand, the special attention to situations of fragility, conflict, and violence on the one hand, but making no, providing no cover for a government whose territory includes underserved populations, but refuses to make a serious effort because somebody else is going to do it. Let me give you an example, a real life example. I've been told by otherwise well-meaning serious country officials that, look, when I asked, why is it that you're not making an effort as you're graduating from middle income, from low to middle income status? Why you're not making an effort to put more money into your health system? And they said, look, we're not stupid. We know that if we don't do anything, those agencies and those advocates who love us more than we love ourselves will declare an emergency, they will hold replenishment meetings, and they will finance it. This is not theory, and this was not one occasion, this was not two occasions. It is there, it is real. So that dependency syndrome is a fundamental problem. It needs to end. Thank you.
Thank you, Soji, that's really great. And Ada, thank you for that question. You may also want to follow up with Soji, because you have been working with CDC, and Soji was responsible for the establishment of a CDC-like organization for Africa. So I think you would have some things, and I'll make sure that I connect the two of you after the session so that you can follow up with them.
Alex, if you allow, just one quick correction. Yes. I was not responsible for it. I was the person who led the charge within the World Bank to secure World Bank financing for the Africa CDC. African
That's perfect.
Established the Africa CDC.
That's perfect. Julie, we now wanted to move to Varun Sabanal from outside. Are you able to promote him? Now, Varun, Dr. Sabanal is a doctor from India who worked in the Indian medical service, had a lot of experience in another continent where we also have low income context, difficult situation. And he's now in the process of doing a degree in health policy management at Columbia, Mount Sinai, and is doing a in-service training as well at this point. Varun, would you like to just reflect on some of this for the group and ask Soji a question?
Thank you, Dr. Preker, and thank you, Dr. Soji. So George, thank you for sharing your wisdom and knowledge. It was really insightful. I have worked with the Indian Armed Forces, being a service medical professional, serving as a doctor in the front line in remote areas, and I can certainly say that India has been one of the biggest recipients of financial aid in the past. And to my question, India as a single country, since it has been the largest recipient of financial aid on a per capita basis, if you compare it with the total population and the demographics, it is kind of a drop in the bucket. And it raises questions about both equity and impact. And has it really, first of all, made a difference of all the financial aid versus the return on investment that has been done? Not to say that it's an investment, but the cooperation that has taken place. And secondly, the second part is India has now been over the recent years recently moving on and becoming less dependent on such financial aid from external agencies. And do you think that there is a kind of a roadmap that countries which are on the similar growth trajectories, they can follow that kind of a road towards achieving self-sufficiency?
Thank you, Varun. That's multiple questions in one. Let's attempt to unpack them, and I will try to do so directly and as directly and succinctly as possible. India is an extraordinary country in terms of its sheer size. Okay? And over the last decade, the country has taken some very important steps on the road to universal health coverage. One of the most recent, of course, being its health insurance program, which is still a work in progress. Some colleagues and I, including the former head that's our colleague there. Five of us, we got together and wrote a paper on this that was published in December in Journal of Global Health, in the Journal of Global Health. So alongside case studies of other countries. Now, note that India still spends quite a small amount of money as a total percentage of GDP, as total health expenditure as a percentage of GDP. It's still pretty low. It was under 5%. Okay? The most recent estimate for 2019. That's one. A second is that the Indian government makes its own policies, and I think that is a fantastic attribute. Quite frankly, they do what they want to do. In my understanding, also, they are very open to collaborating with others in a way that is respectful of the direction in which India wants to go. And I think that is something for other countries to actually emulate. That particular attribute is very important. Now, excuse me. Now, at the same time, there are also serious inequalities within India. And you saw those play out recently during the COVID, the Delta wave of COVID that swept through the country. So there's a lot more work to do there. But when you link it to some of the propositions in this book, I think one of the areas that deserve perhaps more attention, in my view, is concerning India and its neighbors and the sub-region. Is there a case, for example, for a lot more investment in a sub-regional or regional centers for disease control and prevention that works across countries? Now, whether that's going to be a network or whether it's going to be more or less along the lines of the Africa CDC, I don't know. It has to be compatible with the political reality of that sub-region. And of course, continued and additional investments in research and development. And India is already taking strides in that regard. I think also got to give India credit. They have homegrown powerhouses in pharmaceuticals and vaccine manufacturing. So all of this is to say that it's an evolving story. It's got its strengths in terms of going in their own direction, but they're also open to learning from others. Thank you.
Thank you, Soji and Varun. Thank you very much. And we'll follow up, Varun, with you on other things, okay? So the one thing that, you know, we have been talking about low income, but there's a whole other category of countries which may be low income, but may not be low income. And that's what you had mentioned, Soji, fragile states. And I'd like the next person to come will be Miriam Gantos, who was a student of mine a couple of years ago at Columbia, who's now working with AstraZeneca, which will be of interest, especially in the COVID discussion. And Miriam is from Lebanon, which, as many of you have read, is going through a very difficult time, and also comes from a region which is extremely, extremely crushed by civil war and where the impact on health of the political situation is absolutely dramatic. So Miriam, thank you very much for coming and joining us here, and please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Preker. Thank you for the praise of joining us. As Dr. Preker said, Lebanon is in a very fragile state right now. I personally have immigrated from Lebanon, but there are very strong ties there as well as the family. And I used to work as a doctor there, so I have very strong ties with the medical community there as well. So Lebanon, as you have read, is in severe economic crisis and is in desperate need for funding and technical support, especially in the health sector. I have colleagues there, and they're mostly leaving due to lack of funding and just simply not getting paid. There's a drastic lack of access to medications, among other health needs, and the situation is only getting worse. So, can you not hear me? Is there a difficulty with hearing?
We're hearing okay, but it's breaking up a little bit. So just speak closely to the microphone, okay?
Okay. So my question is, what would you say has been the bank and the international success
in addressing critical needs in fragile states like in Lebanon or conflict states like Syria that may not meet the critical fiduciary requirement to be a recipient of World Bank and other international donor assistance?
Thanks. So starting from the general, I do not speak for the World Bank. I'm no longer a World Bank staff member. So I'm speaking as an independent entity on my own understanding is that as part of the global community, a number of those situations have actually benefited from such financing. So if you go back to Bosnia-Herzegovina post-war, which, as I said, I was heavily involved, there was something called the Trust Fund for Bosnia-Herzegovina, and that was what funded much of the work in the early stages. More recently in Yemen, in which I was indirectly involved as director at that time, there was very heavy involvement in financing basic services indirectly through other agencies during the war. Same thing in South Sudan, for example. And I'm also aware of similar commitments to Lebanon. Now, having said that, as you know, far better than I do, the Lebanon has an extraordinarily complex political reality. And my understanding of it is, with the emphasis on continuity of services, with the emphasis on taking care of the displaced populations, and also being attentive to that, the socio-political interface between the resident population and then the displaced population that have come there, the government really has its hands full. So from where I sit, which is distant from Lebanon, my sense of it is that a domestic political resolution is absolutely indispensable, and concurrently, continued international support is also essential for the short term. That's my sense of the dynamics in Lebanon. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Miriam, and also Soji, very, very interesting reflection on that. As you know, I recently did an interview with the outgoing Minister of Health from Afghanistan, which is also in a very precarious situation. And I think one of the things that's happening there is that Afghanistan is now reaching out to its neighbors for collaboration, as Sir George said. And I think this may be part of the answer in some of the countries, is that, you know, there may not be the link possible between the North and the South in some of these situations, where maybe it's actually surrounding countries that are going to be the most likely to provide some sort of collaboration. So thank you very much, ma'am, and we'll follow up afterward. And by the way, we didn't have a chance to talk about your work with AstraZeneca, but, you know, we would love to have a discussion about that, especially in the context of the global COVID pandemic. If we could now have Christina Valencia. Dr. Christina Valencia has been very active in the early part of the COVID response globally. She's working actively in the contact tracing and other things. And Christina is currently pursuing a PhD in public health at Columbia.
Thank you very much, Alex. And Dr. Adeyi, thank you very much for this very interesting and very thought-provoking discussion that you have generated. And may I say, one that is very applicable to many of the situations that we are facing nowadays. You spoke at the very beginning and throughout your presentation and made a lot of emphasis on the notion of building a better future. And it's really nice to hear someone say that, given in the world and the times that we're going through right now. Some might say that that could be even ambitious, to start thinking about better futures when in fact we're still dealing with other things. The first building block that you mentioned in the pathway to build this better future was the need to reallocate or end foreign aid and the aid that is being given. And as you know, in Latin American countries, for example, I think since the beginning of the pandemic, and even previously with the Venezuelan refugee crisis, we have seen more than ever an increase in demand and dependency of this foreign aid, and even countries starting to find new avenues to get this foreign aid made available to them. So with that, I think my question is just really threefold: is how do you envision the process of ending foreign aids in countries, for example, in Latin America, that are really struggling financially, but also whose economies have become so weak? Number two is, do development banks have a role in this process? And do they have a sense of accountability, or can they be held accountable? And three is how, and you touched on this briefly, is how does corruption, something that we are very familiar with and we see a lot throughout Latin American countries, how does corruption factor or will factor into this?
Wow, that's a very good trifecta. So let's go at it as crisply as possible. I have quite a few things to say about corruption in the book, by the way. And whichever way one dices it, corruption reduces the effectiveness of investments in health, whether they're domestic or whether they're external. And so it's something that needs to be tackled continuously. I also note in the book that contrary to tropes that one might see most often in the Northern press, corruption is not unique to the global South. And in fact, I cited some examples about from the United States and from Great Britain. If you've been looking at keeping up with the web recently, you know, billions of pounds of fraudulent transactions under COVID, which they are going to write off. So that's not to excuse corruption. It needs to be tackled. It's bad. Now, on the countries and their economic development, I think the two are intertwined up to a point. One of the things that Sir George mentioned is that health often has a weak voice. The Ministry of Health often has a weak voice domestically. And he wondered aloud whether it's because it's seen as a good thing rather than the instrumental aspect of health as a driver of economic development. I think that's something that folks need to pay more attention to. Second, this call for ending foreign aid for basic health commodities and services is not an abrupt stop. It's actually an 8-year window from now until 2030. So in fact, everybody, countries and external financiers or partners alike, or those providing those engaged in technical cooperation, have an 8-year transition period to do it. Third, in the case of displaced populations, whether it is natural disasters or people displaced by war, for example, I think that is a special case. But it's very different from, quote unquote, a normal country or a stable country. So I think we need to identify, it's almost like a triage function in this case. And in fact, in terms of mutual learning, some of my former colleagues from who are working on the Middle East, on Lebanon and Syria and in support of Libya, actually engaged in some conversations with the former Minister of Health of Colombia on how to mitigate the effects of people crossing the border from Venezuela to Colombia. That was a very interesting aspect of interregional cooperation. Sir George, you notice I'm not using the word assistance anymore.
Well done, Kwaji, well done, well done.
Now, do the development banks have accountability? Yes, the development banks have, they are engaged in the Latin American and Caribbean region. And I need to stress this, the fundamental leadership needs to come from the countries themselves. A development bank cannot substitute, or let me put it differently, should not substitute for the country government in setting policy, in setting the terms of engagement, and in being accountable to its own population. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Christina, and also Soji, very perceptive comment. Christina, I don't know if you know Sir George, but you know, I think it's it would be great with the experience you've had in Latin America if you could maybe have a chance to touch base there, and I'd be happy if George agrees to connect you. So I think it's an amazing work that you've done, especially at this time, and really a risky job that you've had in the last 2 years. So it's really you a great debt for your contribution to this area. Okay, for our final intervention here today is going to be from Caitlin Yu, who's joining us from South Korea. Now, South Korea wouldn't normally be what we would call a recipient of, as George says, international collaboration, but South Korea was very much a recipient at an earlier stage. And you were a student at Columbia. You then went off and on and did some stuff with me at the International Hospital Federation with Planned Parenthood. And then now you're having a chance to implement some of your ideas in the World Bank. So Caitlin, really delighted to see you. And I know that you're right now in South Korea. So, you know, the connection is superb, and it's really nice to see you again.
Thank you very much, Alex, for the introduction. And thank you very much, Soji, for your insightful presentation. It's really nice seeing you after a few years. And the organization is not the same without you. And congratulations on the new publication. I'm looking forward to reading it. I'm Kate. I'm a former student of Alex, who have been a mentor for quite some time. And I graduated from Mailman, I believe now 6 years ago. And I'm currently working at the World Bank, where I also met Soji. So my question is more on countries who are transitioning out from graduating from the foreign aid due to the economic development. So for instance, transitioning from lower to lower middle income countries in the global south, or even countries like South Korea who have been receiving great amount of foreign aid after the World War II, but have graduated. So what may be some of the recommendations for countries who are transitioning out from foreign aid and yet they have created dependence on aid, which became the legacy of pouring out aid for a long time. So for instance, countries like Kenya and Rwanda, Nigeria and Pakistan are graduating from foreign aid with their economic development. So despite being middle income countries, many of them still have high rates of child and maternal mortality, weak health systems, and large shares of population living in poverty. So my question is, what are the roles of the World Bank, USAID, Gates Foundation, and other donors and international community for those who have already graduated or transitioning out so that they are not left out and lost in the dark? Thank you.
Thanks, Caitlin, for your very kind remark. It's good to see you again. And thanks for joining us very bright and early in the morning from South Korea. Look, in the case of South Korea, I think one of the things that is very evident to me from the comparative studies that we have done of country financing and graduation and moving from low income to middle income up there is what I will characterize as a determination to succeed. And I'm not saying that lightly, okay? South Korea benefited a lot from external assistance. My understanding also was that South Korea determined that it was going to succeed. And from my experience, I don't think that determination is universal across many countries. Okay? There are countries that simply have not demonstrated the determination to succeed. So, South Korea on financing, for example, merged all these disparate insurance funds that it had, put in place some quite strong regulatory frameworks. It still has this hospital-centric approach to its system. Well, you know, every unhappy health system is unhappy in its own way. So South Korea also has its own unhappiness. Now with regard to graduation, graduation being the transition from low income status to lower middle income status. Well, as you know, globally, total health expenditure is positively correlated with GDP per capita. The wealthier you are, the more you're spending on the whole in health. And the logical expectation is as countries move from low income status to lower middle income status, and they are weaned off, actually like the imagery of being weaned off something, okay? And they are weaned off the diet of foreign aid, that they will be putting proportionately more of their own resources, i.e. tax-based revenues, into health. But that is not always the case. And so that transition from lower middle from low income to lower middle income with the expected graduation from foreign aid is what we call the economic transition of health or transition of health financing. Where a country or a government of a country does not step up in terms of deliberately committing more of its own public resources to health, then you end up with a situation in which out-of-pocket expenditures become proportionately higher as a percentage of total health expenditure. And this is what you then see manifesting as increased user fees, for example. And that's a very regressive form of financing. The problem with that is the following, and this bears repeating because it goes to the political dynamics, the geodynamics of this problem. You then have a situation whereby the government abdicates its own responsibility. And then a subset, and I'm stressing a subset, it's not everyone, a subset of northern NGOs then start claiming that, oh, it is all the fault of external agencies. That was true 30 years ago. It is no longer the case today. And it's why I said it infantilizes those governments and it provides cover for them to abdicate their own responsibility. Chapter 8 of the book includes a composite vignette that explores this particular dimension. So it's incumbent on countries to be determined to succeed, to up their own game to improve their performance in terms of the proportion, in terms of their own tax revenue collection. That's very important because if you don't have tax revenues, then you're not going to have money in the Ministry of Finance and you don't have nothing to, you don't have money to spend from public resources. So those are dimensions that need to be worked through. What, what can international institutions do in this regard? I think it boils down to aligning themselves with sensible country-led policy. And please, when I say aligning themselves, I'm not talking about the airy-fairy movement of harmonization and alignment and all these endless meetings at, you know, Paris and wherever it is that have been going on. And I'm not also talking about swaps, because again, in chapter 8 of the book, I busted the myth of all of these endless declarations. I'm talking about rigorous work on systems for outcomes, systems for better performance, not harmonization for its own sake. So that's the way I will put it. The country has to determine to succeed. That was evident in South Korea. It's not universal. Secondly, international agencies need to align themselves. And third, attention should be paid to the risk that countries in transition fall into this chasm, which results in higher out-of-pocket expenditures. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Caitlin. And we'll follow up separately. And Soju, thank you for that very reflective thought about those kind of countries that, you know, may not be directly recipient anymore of the kind of support that was given before. We now want to wrap up, and I just wanted, George, if you could give a last reflection on the young leaders that we have seen some of here in this session, and whether you had just a last word of encouragement for the young leaders to pick up the torch from all the things that we have left unfinished.
Thank you very much, Alex. What I would say to them is, right on. I would say to them that it is important not to take doctrinaire positions too early on. That's wrong. It is important when you're young to take doctrinaire positions and fight for what you think your elders think is impossible. For example, the young lady in Lebanon, I would congratulate her on the stand she's taken. The gentleman, the person from the Latin America, working Latin America, I would congratulate on the stand she's taken on corruption, for example. The one message I would leave for them really encapsulates what much of what Soji said, and I would entitle it, they should listen to Bob Marley, and they should listen to a Caribbean calypsoian called Sparrow. Bob Marley said, emancipate yourself from mental slavery. No one but us can free our mind. I would leave that, and Sparrow said, by the sweat of thy brow thou shalt eat bread. Both dicta, I think, are applicable to the young, and I would ask them to bear that in mind and remember that liberation doesn't take place overnight. It is a long struggle, but unless you become engaged in it when you're young, you're not likely to see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Thank you, George. And Soji, any last thoughts for our young leaders?
To our young leaders, first, I want to thank you for taking the time to discuss with us tonight. It's an honor and a great pleasure. I want to pick up from where Sir George left off. This concept of self-emancipation from mental slavery. So colonialism was bad. There's no diluting it. Crimes against humanity were committed and the effects endure. However, wallowing in self-pity or wallowing in victimhood is not going to solve the problem for the Global South. The Global South needs to emancipate itself from neo-dependency. And while we're on the topic of music, let me join Sir George in sharing with you the eternal words of Fela Anikulapo Kuti, who many of you might know as Fela Kuti. And one of his songs was, "Teacher, don't teach me nonsense." So do not let power blocks of the Global North teach you nonsense. Emancipate yourself from mental slavery. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, both Sir George and Dr. Adeyi. Thank you very much for this extremely valuable contribution to our participants today. And we'll make a tape available that can be used both for your own contacts and also for the university. With that, I'm going to close here now this meeting on this special webinar on global health. And those in the class that had joined us from the regular class, everybody should log out at this point and log back onto the regular website where we'll continue.
Thanks very much, Alex.
Thanks, Alex. Thanks, Sir George. Thank you.
Good to see you, Soji.
Good to see you too.
For me.
Thank you. Cheers. Bye-bye.